Tonight on First Tuesday, the nuclear plant at Windscale. How safe is it?
20 years ago, nobody would have thought that the plutonium would actually come back to the land once it's discharged into the sea. Slowly but surely, it's coming back.
We examine the safety records.
And the bells were ringing, they called him the radioactive man at Windscale.
We check pollution around the plant.
It's the hottest spot I've found.
And we ask what caused the cancers in the local children.
If I were a parent in the village, I would be concerned about my children.
Good evening and welcome to the November edition of First Tuesday. Tonight our programme is devoted to one subject, an issue which provokes passionate and divisive debate. Nuclear energy is what we call that virtually unlimited source of power which derives from splitting the atom. Energy which can be used to make weapons for war, or in peace, to provide fuel for nuclear power stations.
For whatever purpose, the production of nuclear power is surrounded by controversy. The benefits of abundant energy have to be set against anxieties about accident or sabotage. And then there's the waste. The radioactive remains from producing nuclear energy. And it's this which forms the main subject of our film. Tonight, we reveal what we believe to be disturbing new evidence about the most controversial nuclear plant of all, Windscale.
The film raises one central question. Is the operation at Windscale as safe as the authorities claim? Or does it expose people, especially children, to unacceptable levels of radiation? We'll be debating that in the studio later. But first, the evidence in Windscale, the nuclear laundry.
The Lake District. On its western fringes, the mountains and fells roll down to the Irish Sea. Every year, the Cumbrian seashore attracts tourists from all over Britain. What the holidaymakers don't know is that this coastline is one of the most radioactive environments in the world. The radioactivity here can be measured quite simply with a Geiger counter. It's in the mud and it's on the beach. Scientist Dr. Philip Day is measuring this radioactive pollution.
Well, that's a reading of 5, possibly 6. Average of 5, I think.
Pounds per second.
Pounds per second. So the radiation here is about 5 times background.
This abnormal level of radioactivity on a holiday beach is caused by nuclear waste. It's washed up from a giant atomic energy plant, Windscale, the biggest commercial nuclear reprocessing works in the world. Windscale's radioactive effluent is discharged down this pipeline into the Irish Sea. Around the pipeline, it's highly radioactive.
Well, I'm getting a reading of 40 counts per second here, which is really quite considerable. The natural background here is, the natural background would be about 0.01. So this is 100 times, approximately 100 times the natural background level that one might find elsewhere in the country.
Every year, Britain's nuclear power stations send over 1,000 tons of burnt-up nuclear fuel to Windscale. And from the other side of the world, the Japanese send off their nuclear waste to Britain. So do Italy, Germany, Switzerland, Spain, Holland and Sweden. Orders worth £2.5 billion. Nuclear waste reprocessing is a controversial industry. Only the French continue it on a scale approaching ours. Windscale is the world's nuclear laundry. Its critics call it a nuclear dustbin. Windscale's job, to extract plutonium from burnt-up reactor fuel. Plutonium for Britain's atomic energy or for nuclear warheads. It's a valuable but highly dangerous radioactive element. At the end of the process, Windscale is left with a lethal residue, high-level nuclear waste that will stay radioactive for the next 1,000 years. For now, it's stored here, shielded by 9-foot-thick walls of concrete and steel. The dangers of radiation are well established. It can cause leukemia and other cancers. So the strictest safety precautions are essential for workers. Windscale is run by the state-owned British Nuclear Fuels Limited, BNFL. With 6,000 workers, it's the biggest employer in the region, and BNFL are proud of their safety record.
We have had incidents, of course, like any other industry in the country. We have had incidents. We consider that these have been carefully controlled and dealt with. The incidents have primarily involved leakage from plants and equipment. This has been contained. Modifications have been done in agreement with the NII, the Nuclear Installations Inspectorate, and I think that our record bears scrutiny.
That safety record begins with one of the world's worst nuclear accidents. In 1957, this reactor producing plutonium for Britain's first H-bomb caught fire. It burnt out of control for 2 days and released a cloud of radioactive iodine gas.
The trouble arose when radioactive dust from the overheated pile fell on the Cumberland pastures and milk samples rushed to Harwell were found to contain 6 times as much radioactive iodine as international health standards permit. So for the time being, down the drain it goes.
The government inquiry concluded reassuringly, it is in the highest degree unlikely that any harm has been done to the health of anybody. That now seems over-optimistic. In 1957, Alex Bryson was 10. On the day the Windscale reactor caught fire, she was a mile downwind from the accident at this school in Seascale. In 1979, aged 32, she went to her doctor with a swelling on her neck.
He told me that I'd got a papillary carcinoma of thyroid, and so that needed to be operated on immediately. I've got a large scar which goes right the way around, and another small one there.
This year, the government re-examined the likely human cost of the fire. Today's estimate, 33 deaths and genetic defects, 247 cases of thyroid cancer, like Alex Bryson's.
You know, I went through quite a lot of trauma, and, you know, it took quite a long time to get back to normal again. And as I say, I've got this very big scar. I have to take tablets daily, which I couldn't live without.
In addition to the 1957 fire, the Windscale safety record shows more than 300 reported accidents, leaks and emergencies. This is BNFL's own incident count, major and minor. On at least 200 occasions, workers have suffered radiation overdoses. Over 60 accidents involve plutonium contamination. Incident number 42, September 1963. That year, Jonathan Troughton had 3 times the safety limit of plutonium in his body. 9 years later, he developed cancer.
They found it, actually, it was a long name, but it was bone marrow cancer. He had cancer of the marrow.
And what are the effects of that particular form of cancer?
Oh, dear. All kinds of effects it had on him, that his bones jumped out. And
was he in a lot of pain?
He was at the time that they jumped out, but once he got going again, it seemed to ease off. But he had painkillers. Wherever he went, he had a bottle of painkillers. We couldn't hardly touch him. We didn't know where to lift him. All his bones were out of joint.
In 1975, Jonathan Troughton died from myeloma, a bone marrow cancer especially sensitive to radiation. BNFL paid Mrs. Troughton £22,000 in settlement. Another plutonium worker, Malcolm Patterson, he died aged 36 of leukemia. BNFL admitted liability and paid his widow £67,000 compensation. This is Windscale's own list of 41 other workers, all of them withdrawn from plutonium work because of internal bodily contamination, in one case at up to 50 times the Windscale limit. Throughout the 60s and 70s, incidents occurred regularly. Incident number 110, September 1973. A blowback occurred while processing a new type of atomic fuel, and radioactive ruthenium gas filled this building. 35 men were contaminated. One of them was a supervisor, Stanley Higgins. He received a radiation dose 60 times greater than a Windscale worker is allowed in a whole year, so high that his body itself became radioactive.
Each week, it was tested on the monitors there. And the bells were ringing, they called him the radioactive man at Windscale.
In 1979, Stanley Higgins died from a heart attack. He was 50. BNFL deny his death was connected with the overdose. but his widow plans to sue the company. Throughout the 1970s, incidents continued. Further down the list, October 1976, incident number 160. A leak was discovered in a nuclear waste silo. Over 4 years, thousands of gallons had seeped unnoticed from this silo into the surrounding soil. Today, 7 years later, the silo is still leaking slowly. In their own internal study, BNFL claimed that the cancer rate among their workers is lower than normal, but their data has yet to be analysed by independent experts. Not all Windscale's leaks and accidents have been contained on site. 14 times radioactivity has escaped. Nearby fields have been contaminated. Tyson Dawson farms right up to the Windscale fence. Since Windscale opened, he's had 40 unusual deaths amongst his cows.
Well, last spring actually was the worst. I had calves born that were born without hair on their legs and, and rather deformed tongues and ears, and extremities seemed to be slightly deformed. This all happened just in 1 week. It was about three calves were all born in the 1 week. And then this year, the same thing occurred again. 1 week I had two calves born again in similar circumstances, out of completely different cows, so they were nowhere related as such, you see.
In October 1981, there was a leak of radioactive iodine gas. Farmer Dawson's cows were grazing in the next field.
It was one young animal that was born sometime during last summer, and it was on this farm till the end of October. And about a couple of months afterwards, it began to go off its feed. And we wondered why, you see. It was, so I called the vet in, and they said, oh, it was some growths on its mouth, you see. He said, look at its mouth, you see, and you can see these pretty, they were pretty horrible. And he said, there were cancerous growths, and they were right down its gullet into its stomach, you see, and there was no way this animal could have lived.
After a series of bad leaks, government safety inspectors concluded that the standard of the plants at Windscale in the early 70s had deteriorated to an unsatisfactory level. In another report, they criticised the management as lacking in the level of judgment and safety consciousness demanded. They found BNFL had broken the law, but decided not to prosecute. As well as these leaks and accidents, Windscale, as a matter of daily routine, pumps radioactive waste into the environment through this concrete-covered pipeline, the biggest systematic discharge of nuclear waste from any civil atomic installation in the world. 1 million gallons a day of liquid nuclear waste. It's pumped 2 miles from Windscale out into the Irish Sea. Such dumping is banned in America. No country in the world allows Windscale's level of discharge. Out of the pipeline pour over 30 different radioactive elements, among them plutonium, which sinks to the seabed and attaches to the silt and mud of the ocean floor. 30 years ago, when the pipeline was built, it was thought the plutonium would stay safely out at sea. But government scientists now know that currents bring the contaminated silt back to the shoreline, washing it up in local estuaries with every tide. Nevertheless, BNFL are confident that the situation is under control.
The levels against which we operate on the site, the discharges that we make to the environment, are all very closely supervised. And I think if other sections of industry had the same degree of surveillance as we have, you might not have had your dioxin incidents on Flixborough and the like. We sample the grass, we sample the milk, we sample the air, we sample the sea, we sample the shellfish, mollusks and winkles, we sample the fish, we sample the seaweed, and we sample the sea itself and the atmosphere. Government departments don't just accept our data. They do carry out their own spot checking, and they confirm that we are living to within their limits.
Britain still sticks to radiation dose limits for the public, recommended by an international commission a quarter of a century ago. They are increasingly under attack, and in America, such limits are 20 times more stringent. Professor Edward Radford.
Well, I believe that the effects of radiation that we now know about have considerably increased from what we knew about, say, 10 or 15 years ago. The exposure limits for the general public which apparently are still in effect in the UK, but which have been lowered substantially in the United States, that these limits are also not adequately protecting the general public. There is absolutely no safe level in the usual kind of context.
So the return to the shore of even the smallest amount of Windscale's waste is now concerning British scientists like Peter Taylor.
20 years ago, nobody would have thought that the plutonium would actually come back to the land once it's discharged into the sea. In the last 5 years, research has shown that it is coming back. Slowly but surely, it's coming back. Over the last 25 years, a quarter of a ton of this material has been discharged through that pipeline. And it's out there in those sediments, only a few miles off the coast. The sediments are moving. The plutonium is more mobile than we thought it was. And it is extremely toxic.
As a result, the Windscale coastline is now closely monitored by scientists, checking for radioactive pollution. How significant is the Windscale discharge?
Compared with anywhere else in this country, or indeed the rest of the world, it's very much larger, by at least a factor of 10. In fact, this single discharge is probably larger than all other marine discharges throughout the world that we know about put together. It's estimated that some 90-95% of all the plutonium that's ever been discharged from here has settled in the ocean, on the seabed, within, say, 25 to 30 kilometres of this point. The plutonium, which is on the seabed there, will be active for 30, 60, maybe 100,000 years. And, of course, some of that is carried along the coast and is deposited on the shore or in the estuaries, for instance, at Ravenglass. The radioactive material will accumulate, and does indeed accumulate, year by year.
There is a natural level of radiation everywhere. It comes, for example, from the sun and from certain rocks, and varies slightly from place to place. This very low level is called background radiation. We commissioned Dr. Day to test the environment around Windscale. His brief, to discover just how high the local radioactivity is.
Let's see what the reading was here.
This is the Ravenglass estuary, 5 miles south of Windscale. How does the radioactivity here compare with that natural background level?
Oh, yes, it's quite active, isn't it? About 10 counts per second off that.
That is 10 times higher than background radiation. These salt marsh fields border the Ravenglass estuary. The levels of radiation here are even higher.
What's that like?
It's the hottest spot I've found. We found that level in our benches. We'd be sawing up the bench.
Back at Manchester University, the mud samples from Ravenglass are dried and analysed. The result? They all contain radioactive elements and at much higher levels than normal.
The ones from that particular field were from 50 to 100 times the value we found in the estuary, so it would be at least 100 times the natural background levels. The levels we found at that point were a considerable surprise to me. They represent quite a radiation hazard for people walking at that spot. It struck me as somewhat of an anomaly to have sheep and animals, which are clearly eventually for human consumption, grazing in surroundings of that type. The plutonium supposedly concentrates in various organs in the sheep. From the point of view of human consumption, I think the liver is the most important. If I knew that I was being given a plateful of liver from that particular sheep, I'd be very upset.
So what about eating fish from the Irish Sea? Are they contaminated by radiation from Windscale as well? Dr. Day took a sample of the local catch.
I'd like some plaice, please.
Coming up. How many? What size?
I should think 3 plaice. Just straight off the top there. In the fish, we found levels of radioactivity approximately double the ones reported in the most recent government report on the subject. Certainly, if you went down there and ate one fish and chip supper and then went away again, really there would be no hazard. If you lived there and ate those fish every day, well, despite what is in the official reports, I think, yes, you would be exposing yourself to an unreasonable amount of radioactivity.
Every year, BNFL and the government measure radioactive contamination in the fish in the Irish Sea. They've found that certain radioactive elements show up 5,000 times higher in fish caught near Windscale than in fish from Iceland. The government now admits that local people who eat a lot of fish and shellfish have exceeded the maximum recommended radiation dose for lifetime exposure. But Dr. Day now has a problem: how to dispose of his radioactive mud samples.
The total amount of radioactivity they contain, particularly the plutonium, is much more than I can legitimately put in any of our normal waste bins. We can't go having it put on the Manchester tip. The bags must be sealed up and put into our radioactive waste disposal system, and I think they will probably end up on the Drigg site.
But that's at Windscale, where they came from.
Well, yes, there's a certain wry irony about this whole process.
The problem of radioactive waste is not confined to the Cumbrian coast. The discharges are spreading, carried by tides up to Scotland. This is Kipford, a resort on the Solway Firth, nearly 40 miles from Windscale and the pipeline. Like many estuaries on the western Scottish coast, it has a shoreline of mud and silt. Dr. Richard Scott, a molecular biologist from Edinburgh University, is monitoring the mud here for radioactive pollution.
Normal background radiation gives about 2 counts per second on this meter. At this moment, we're getting about 10. So in other words, at the moment, we're getting about 5 times the normal level of radiation.
What sort of readings are you getting there, Dr. Scott?
Well, I'm getting, as you can see, just over 20, and that represents about 10 times the normal background count. Radioactivity comes from the Windscale and Calder works of British Nuclear Fuels. It is released from a pipeline and travels up the coast in this direction. What we're really concerned with is the radioactive composition of the muds, because these can be finally airborne if the silt is dried out and the wind is strong enough.
If the silt dries out, can the radioactive mud and dust get into people at all?
Well, of course it can, via their lungs.
What about the people that live here then?
Well, I'm afraid they've got to live with it. There's no way that the contamination can be removed now.
200 miles further north still, and directly in the path of the Windscale waste stream, lie the Hebrides. A Scottish research team were studying kidney patients when they noticed that people from the Hebrides had a small but measurable amount of radioactive cesium-137 in their blood, up to 8 times as high as people from England.
My own opinion is that I would be surprised if there wasn't some contribution from output from Windscale.
There's growing concern over Windscale's discharges, alarming new evidence that people absorb 5 times more plutonium from fish and shellfish than previously thought, has prompted BNFL to cut plutonium dumping by 15% a year. But it's too late to stop the radioactive plutonium already in the sea. That'll be coming ashore for years to come. So has Windscale's dumping policy been a mistake?
I think that the practices that have been slowly developing over the years at the Windscale Works exemplify the extent to which the warnings, the indications from the evidence that has been emerging over this time have been ignored. In other words, there has been the sort of pious hope on the part of those who have been responsible in this area that, in fact, things will not turn out to be so bad after all. Now, in the case of the Windscale Works, and in particular the dumping into the Irish Sea, I think that the worst has happened, and that the contamination is potentially much more serious than I think anyone would have realized 20 years ago.
Cumbria's remote coastline was chosen as the ideal site for Britain's first atomic bomb factory. That was back in 1947. Today, Windscale's reprocessing operations are exposing people living near the coast to radioactive pollution. They can't avoid it. When the contaminated estuary mud dries out, radioactive dust particles can be measured, blowing in the air. This air monitor is at Ravenglass. And this device collects traces of plutonium and other radioactive elements blown in with the sea spray. But if radioactive dust is being picked up by these monitors, could it be blowing into the nearby houses too? It's hard to believe, but it's something that the authorities don't seem to have looked into. We asked Dr. Day to check. He began at the home of Mr. and Mrs. Merlin in Ravenglass.
That's a Hoover bag. That's taken from your vacuum cleaner, is that right?
Yes.
Good, thank you very much. We'll put that in here. See what we find in that then.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Goodbye. Right. Okay.
Their household dust is analysed with startling results.
In fact, you wouldn't expect to find any plutonium in dust in a house, and we found plutonium and americium, both of them important radioactive materials, in this dust. One would imagine that it would be possible for such dust to be transferred directly to food or even eaten directly by children.
Plutonium, once inside the body, can cause cancer, so the Merlins are understandably worried.
If it's coal dust, if it's something which you can see, then people have something tangible to fear.
Mm.
It's only if you inquire a little bit beyond that that you realise how insidious the danger is and how long it is here and that it is building up. It's not just a level which is being maintained and
it's
monitored. It is increasing. I hope to God that we haven't suffered from it, but I think if we lived here the rest of our life, one of our family of four might well suffer from it.
So what are you going to do about it?
We are moving, as soon as we can sell the house. For what, I don't know.
The average person, I wouldn't think, would want to live in a house with plutonium in it. Major worry is, of course, the children. They're 6 1/2 and 5 1/4. They're very active, they're very lively, and, of course, to us, they're very dear and precious. I wish them to grow up to be normal, ordinary human beings leading a healthy life and reproduce themselves. I find it absolutely unbelievable that in any way this has been jeopardised through completely no fault of our own or theirs.
We know from many other instances where materials have been carried into houses by workmen or in other ways that this is a potentially very significant source of exposure, especially to children living in the house. If I were a parent in the village, I would be concerned about my children.
The Merlin home was no isolated case. Dr. Day sampled dust from 9 houses, 6 around Windscale, 3 at Kipford in Scotland. They all contained small amounts of radioactive plutonium, and these wind-blown radioactive particles are not found just on the coast. Official measurements show they are encroaching steadily inland. Could this be dangerous for the local population?
There is a pathway to the human population, and including sea spray and other sources onto the shore. That means that these people, I believe, are being exposed year in, year out to higher levels of radioactivity than they should, and that will lead to a cancer risk ultimately, which I think I would consider unacceptable if I were living there.
So we asked West Cumbria's District Medical Officer, Dr. John Terrell, about the pattern of cancer in his area.
Yes, I would say that the picture is basically a normal one, quite comparable with the rest of the country generally as far as cancer, and both young people and older people is concerned in this district.
Well, have you looked at the cancer rates in any of the smaller areas, for example, the villages on the coast near Windscale?
Not particularly, no. This is something which would certainly justify quite a study of this. You're quite right.
We investigated the cancer rates of the coastal villages nearest to the Windscale pipeline. Far from being normal, we discovered a disturbing number of cancers in young people, and that was without access to medical records. Bootle, 10 miles from Windscale, a farming village with a population of just 800. Farmer's daughter, Elizabeth Fox, dead from leukemia at 17. Her school friend, Brenda Pritt, dead at 26 from Hodgkin's disease, a cancer of the lymph glands. And from the same school, a third young cancer victim, Barbara Graham. In 1980, she died aged 33 from stomach cancer. She left her husband, Geoffrey, to bring up their daughters, Christine and Barbara Ann.
The doctors told us it happened to somebody 30 years before the time, you know, 30 to 40 years before it should have done.
Death from stomach cancer is very rare in a woman of Barbara Graham's age. Only 4 in 1,000,000. Even rarer, just 3 in 1,000,000, was this 4-year-old Bootle girl's death from kidney cancer. So what do the villagers make of these unusually young cancer deaths?
Nobody really seems to talk about it, you know what I mean? It's cancer and that's it, you know. Seems to be taboo, you know. We tried to keep it quiet ourselves, but it got out, you know, in the end.
In Bootle and Wobbathwaite, with their tiny populations, only one child under 18 should develop cancer every 30 years. We found 4 in 20 years. But the closer to Windscale, the worse the picture becomes. Seascale village, with a population of 2,000, is just 1.5 miles from Windscale. Here, since 1950, the year that Windscale began its operations, we found 11 cases of childhood cancer. Of these 11 children from Seascale village, 7 were victims of leukemia, the form of cancer most easily induced by radiation. Was the district medical officer aware of the disturbingly high rate of childhood cancer in his area?
Well, yes, but I mean, one has to look at this in terms of the numbers concerned, and one has to study it over a, as I said before, over a prolonged period before you can attribute too much significance to this.
We put our findings to 3 experts. All agreed they were highly significant.
Well, you found 7 cases of leukemia. 5 of those cases are for children under 10. Now, let's take those children under 10. That's 5 cases in 30 years. You would expect 1 case in 60 years. In other words, you have found 10 times the national average. The chances of that occurring naturally is 1 in 10,000. Now, that is just off scale. I mean, when you get those sort of figures, what is happening is not natural.
BNFL accept that the Windscale operations may cause a small number of cancers.
I'm in no doubt at all that operations on this site could statistically lead to cancers. And that's been publicised in the past, as you well know, by other organisations. But I think we should bear in mind the fact that these statistical cancers are, as they say, hypothetical cancers and have to be judged against the cancers that occur naturally anyway.
Geoffrey Runton died aged 12 from bone cancer in his rib, a condition so rare, 1 in 1,000,000, that there was only one other death in his age group throughout the country that year. He was one of the 14 childhood cancer cases we found on the Windscale coast.
And at that stage, the doctors were hopeful that he would respond to chemotherapy, as we'd caught it so early. But he didn't. But I think it dawned gradually, if you like, on me that he wasn't going to. And after he had the last treatment, which the doctors and I knew was the last one, if it worked, we'd go on with more, but if this one didn't work, that was going to be the last one. And one was aware the next morning that it hadn't worked, that he was no better. He just went into a deeper sleep than he was in.
Take the Bootle and Seascale cancer figures for young people under 18. You've found 14 cases so far. You would expect a total of only 3 cases. Now, the chances of that happening naturally is 1 in 100,000. If you ignore one of the parishes, which is virtually a nature reserve, then the chances of that happening is one in a million. What is particularly worrying about the figures you've found so far is that the problem seems to be growing. I mean, for example, you've got a place like Wobbethwaite in the middle of the Ravenglass estuary. It's a tiny little place. Less than a dozen children are born there every year. You'd expect one childhood cancer once every 160 years. So why have you found two cases within the last 5 years?
Of course it's of concern, yes.
So what are you going to do about it?
We're going to try to elucidate, if at all possible, whether in fact this is so. But what I'm saying to you is I do not consider it as evidence to say to the people of Seascale and the surrounding area, you are living in a dangerous health environment and should get out of it. I don't think the evidence is there for that.
Have you shown them what the evidence is so they can make their own minds up?
I haven't done so, but I haven't concealed it. And you're mentioning the evidence, that's fair enough. Fine, it's all entirely valid that you should make this available, that you should indicate these facts.
Even without access to medical records, we found a childhood leukemia rate 10 times the national average in the village next to Windscale. There may be more. And that's against a background of official figures showing that throughout rural West Cumbria, male cancers have risen from 10% below the national average to 20% above in the last dozen years. If the radioactive contamination from the Windscale pipeline is to blame for the disturbing rise in cancers, what should be done?
I feel very sorry for the people, and I certainly would not want to feel that this program or my statements are meant to unduly alarm them, but I do think that a serious problem has been allowed to develop, and in the process I think some steps are going to have to be taken to face it. I would recommend that they stop dumping through that pipeline, certainly the long-lived radionuclides, and do that forthwith.
There's nothing, once you have discharged, this is why we are against discharging. If you get it wrong, there's nothing that you can do about it, except evacuate, except close off the areas.
There were hundreds of kids here yesterday, all paddling around down there, all in the water and making sand castles out of this silt and mud and sand here. And there is this terrible, terrible hidden menace that's insidious, you see. You can't see it, touch it, smell it. You have no knowledge of where it is and what it's doing.
2 weeks ago, BNFL reassured the public. The discharges, they said, create no hazards to people who live locally or elsewhere.
To say the least, a disturbing film, not only for people who live near Windscale, but for the rest of us as well. Here in the studio, we have those on both sides of the issue and at the center of the debate. Jonathan.
Well, the questions raised by that film are pretty clear. Are the children who died of cancer, in effect, victims of Windscale? Is the plutonium in those houses a threat to the families who live in them? Is there altogether too much radioactivity in the sea, on the land, and in the air around Windscale? Should there be a full inquiry? To debate these things in the studio, Professor Edward Radford, who you saw in the film, Peter Wilkinson, who's the director of Greenpeace, and on the other side of the argument, Professor John Fremlin, and from British Nuclear Fuels, who operate the plant, Peter Mummery. Mr. Mummery, in the light of that film, do you want to modify at all the statement at the end of it from BNFL to the effect that the discharges from Windscale create no hazards to people who live locally or elsewhere?
No, I don't wish to amend that in any way. I'd like to pick up the points that you've raised. First of all, the question of the cancers. Now, anyone who has a family is very concerned about cancers, particularly in young children. The data that is produced needs examination, but let us assume, first of all, that it is correct. Then the assertion the program makes is that those excess cancers are linked with radiation. Now, leukemia occurs naturally, and natural radiation exists. Therefore, if leukemia is due to radiation, the normal rate of cancer incidence is due to natural radiation or to a small part of natural radiation. If we make the best approximation we can carry out, then you can see that in order to obtain 10 times the natural rate of leukemia, pretty well all the children at Seascale would have had to have been exposed to at least 10 and perhaps 100 times natural radiation every hour of every day of every year of their lives. Now, that gets us to the activity, and the activity levels are known, and that is just not contemplatable.
Can we stick with those statistics? Those statistics, as I understand it, were checked by two, three outside statisticians, and they regarded them as being significant
and disturbing. Yes, but that's not disturbing. The point, Mr. Dimbleby. The point you are making in the film is their connection with radiation, and that is the point I'm dealing with. As far as whether the statistics are ones which are a cause of concern generally, that's a matter for detailed study. Clearly, these clusters, exceptionally high frequencies, exist, and historically they're known to experts. There is one north of London, for example, where you have four children and one adult, all within a few months, diagnosed of leukemia. But that's not the main point. The main point is the connection with radiation, and I've dealt with that.
Would you not agree that in the absence of any other known cause, then one would have to consider that Windscale might be a cause, given the very strong link between radiation and leukemia?
But I've already indicated to you why the strong link between radiation and leukemia is not capable of explaining the results.
So you repudiate absolutely that Windscale could be the cause of those cancers?
Yes, I do. That isn't to say that the cause should not be investigated.
Now, when you say the cause should be investigated, you haven't investigated that yourselves. You didn't know about it until now. Do you, to that extent, welcome the emergence of this evidence?
Well, I think the area health authorities have already made it clear that they are studying the health statistics in the area, and NRPB with them is making those studies, and we support those studies, but that's a different matter from the question of the allegation in this programme that those cancers are caused by radiation.
Can I just stick with that one point for a moment? Would you accept, however, just so that we get it completely clear, that when the film says that the likelihood of this occurring naturally is something in the order of 10,000 to 1, that that is a fair statement?
Well, it all depends. First of all, you have you checked whether the number of children in the Seascale population is consistent with the national average? If there was a factor of two difference and Seascale was a young population, then that probability of 1 in 6,000 rather than 1 in 10,000 would reduce dramatically. But this is not the point of the programme. The point of the programme is the allegation against radioactivity, and I really would like to move on to that, Mr. Dimbleby.
We will in just a moment. I'd like to stick with this just for one moment, if I may, simply to clear it up. If you felt that those figures were attributable to Windscale, would that affect your operation, or would that be, however unfortunate, a price that you believe we have to pay for nuclear energy? If you believe there was a connection, if it could be shown at some stage that there were such a connection?
Well, obviously we would respond to any facts that were established in the way that we respond already to working within regulatory limits and new information. Now, this question of activity that I've referred to, the programme talks about hazards to children playing and walking on the beach and nearby and so on. Many of us, myself included, have families whose children have played on these beaches, and we do not consider that a cause of concern. The activity levels referred to in the programme, determined by Dr. Day, are not new. They've been published. Dr. Day himself, I understand, has said that his results are in no way inconsistent with those that have been published by MAF and BNFL in their annual discharge reports. And if you take account of those levels and the time that it is possible, reasonably practicable, for children to play on the beaches and the rest of it, then the radiation they're exposed to is in fact no more than a few percent of natural background.
Can I ask why research has not been done inside the houses to determine the level of plutonium dust in those houses?
Well, we now talk about plutonium. Now, plutonium, we have two routes for intake of plutonium, one you breathe in and one you eat. The one that is principally of concern, I think, and this was identified before the Windscale inquiry, that's 7 years ago now, was the question of plutonium in the atmosphere. We made measurements in 1976. They were discussed at the Windscale inquiry. They are published regularly ever since and discussed at the bodies set up for the purpose with the local community, the Sellafield Local Liaison Committee.
But you
and
don't?
These results show that the amount of plutonium in the atmosphere is less than 1% of that which is permitted. We also know from the data on the dust that you'd have to eat 20 pounds of that dust in a year to reach the permitted limits.
We'll undoubtedly come back to one or two of these things in a moment. I'd like, if I could, just to go back to my question, though, which is, why do you not monitor inside the houses when I think I'm right, that the Royal Commission's report said that houses, built environments, it's referred to, ought to be monitored for dust?
I don't know the particular reference to which you have in mind there, but the point is that the monitoring has been carried out in the environment immediately outside houses. There is advice which suggests that the level which you find inside a house is likely to be lower rather than higher, which you find outside the house. The matter was discussed at the Windscale inquiry. It was concluded then that the sensible thing to do was to extend the measurements outside the houses rather than inside the houses.
One more question before we move on. If there is no threat, no hazard, as you state, why is it that you are proposing to cut back what you discharge from Windscale?
Well, the discharges from Windscale also lead to radiation exposure to what are called the voracious seafood eaters. And new data, which you refer to in the programme, indicates that the significance of this will go up by a considerable factor.
So in order to reduce the hazard, you're going to be cutting back.
In response to that, as we have done in previous years, we propose to cut back the actinide discharges. Now, your programme referred to the fact that this plutonium was coming back to the coast. This was new evidence, and it was increasing. Now, Mr. Dimbleby, those points are just not correct. It is not new evidence. The evidence was available before and at the time of the Windscale inquiry. And the measurements made since that time, and regularly collected and reported, demonstrate that the amount of plutonium in the environment, in the estuary, in Raven Glass, for example, has actually been decreasing over the last 5 years, not increasing.
We will be able to come back to some of these things in a moment. I'd like to have a turn
so
to...
So can I just say, Mr. Dimbleby, once again, that I believe that our statement is fully justified.
That there is no hazard. Right. That's very, very clear. Professor Radford, are you reassured by what you've heard Mr. Mummery say in the light of the evidence of that film, or do you still hold to your general views as stated in the film?
I'm not at all reassured, unfortunately. Many of the issues that surround this whole question were indeed brought up at the time of the Windscale inquiry, as Mr. Mummery says, and I did not feel that the inquiry dealt with them adequately then, and I don't think they've been dealt with adequately since. Let's take, for example, the issue...
Yeah, I'd like if we could to deal with the issue of the children, the cases, and the statistics relating to those leukemia deaths. Do you accept that it might not be Windscale that causes it?
Well, there is an excess of deaths in that community. It is correct to say that it should be investigated whether there might be other causes. I do think, however, the fact that at least several of these cancers in the children, including the leukemias, are of a type that we know are particularly likely to be due to radiation. That is, radiation produces that type, including bone cancer. So if, in fact, the most likely candidate, and certainly one has to consider that to be the most likely candidate, namely the effluents from Windscale, then Mr. Mummery is quite correct. It suggests that the exposures have been substantially higher than were thought. Now, there can be several avenues by which the children might have been exposed. For example, airborne releases, eating seafood, or picking up house dust, for example. So I think at this point it's simply premature to say on what basis the radiation exposures have been higher than we thought, if in fact they have been, and that still has to be established.
May I just ask Professor Redford, does he agree that in fact most of the children in Seascale would have had to be exposed to at least 10 and perhaps 100 times the levels of natural radiation in order for these figures to apply?
Oh, indeed. I think that's a fair statement.
Thank you. Because that throws the emphasis back, Mr. Dimbleby, onto the measurements of the level of radioactivity. And here I think we are on somewhat firmer ground than perhaps it might be understood.
But you're saying it's quite possible that they would have received that kind of dose from Windscale.
Well, unfortunately, it's been my experience that that in the whole nuclear industry, pathways to populations turn out to be present that hadn't been anticipated previously. And I think, for example, a plutonium pathway through the house dust and so on is one that has not received adequate attention.
It's also your general view that the levels permitted are much too high. That's what you said in the film. Can you say why you think that the levels ought to be sharply reduced to the kind of levels that are permitted in America?
Well, I think we have to distinguish two types of exposure limits. The first one is that the exposure limits, I think, for overall exposure, that is a total combination of all materials that are absorbed, are indeed substantially lower in the United States than they are in the UK. And I think that that particular kind of aggregate exposure should be restricted more than it was. But over and above that, there have to do with the questions of the concentrations, either in food or water or air. All of these concentrations are established, and I think that the concentrations are based, these concentrations are established based on the way in which the authorities feel the people will be exposed. And I think the new evidence suggests that they should be substantially lowered, because I think the risks are greater.
Now, would you comment then on what Mr. Mummery says, that the children, for instance, in that house would have to eat 20 pounds worth of dust in order to be seriously at risk?
I didn't say seriously at risk, Mr. Dimbleby.
I'm sorry,
said to reach the permitted limit, which is quite a different
matter. Do you believe they would be at risk below the permitted limit then?
No, I do not.
So it's the same thing in effect?
Well, it doesn't mean that if you go above the limit, people are then seriously at risk.
That's right, I'm sorry. Okay. Well, let us put it that way, that they'd have to eat 20 pounds of this dust to reach the limit, whether or not they'd be at risk.
Well, I don't see how Mr. Mummery or anyone else can make that kind of statement, because there are so many unknowns. Now, certainly...
I'm using the results which Dr. Dare gave on the program as to the radioactive content of the dust.
Yes, but I also analyzed some dust samples from the Merlin House, and what we found was that it was highly variable within the Hoover bag, so that the first question is, in what form is it, and would it be more likely that certain portions of that dust could be more readily taken up? We don't know the chemical form of the radionuclides. We aren't certain of the solubility and factors like that. So that it's very premature, I think, to say how much of what would be necessary to deliver what dose.
Well, Professor, I just want to bring in Professor Fremner here and to move on, if we can, to the discharges. Now, if I'm right, back in 1971 or so, the permitted level of discharges increased for plutonium by about threefold. Now it's being sharply cut back. Now, you played a part in that earlier decision. Can you explain the apparent contradiction? One moment it appears to be safe to increase it, and the next moment you have to reduce it rather sharply.
I didn't have anything to do with the first decision. At that time I was interested, but had done no work. Since that, I have, with a research student, made measurements of the amount of plutonium in mussels from the area, and the amount of this which was taken up by rats, and we found that the level taken up by rats was perhaps twice as much as had been expected. NRPB have done more work, and they now say five times as much as used to be expected.
Do you generally share the view that Mr. Mummery has expressed that there is no hazard from Windscale?
I don't believe that there is any human activity in which there is no hazard. I don't know what you mean by no hazard. If you mean, is it as dangerous as letting children walk to school without crossing the road? It's much less dangerous than that. But that doesn't mean no hazard.
Well, let us say that there is no risk of people acquiring cancer or other diseases as a consequence of the radiation emitted from Windscale.
There is a finite risk, but my view is that it's far too small, because the way I'd taken it was that if the dust in the house was purely consisted of nothing whatever except the sediment which has been collected by a number of the people using those muslin screens and things of this sort, then the amount of activity, the average activity of this was known, and to get the number of cancers which have been observed, I mean, there's 10, and I'm very glad that these have been shown up. Your point, I accept your point, and I think it is a valuable point produced by the film that these large numbers of cancers exist. But in order to produce that number on the existing figure of plutonium, one would find that every person in Seascale would have had to be eating a gram or 2 grams of this sediment every day of their lives, throughout their lives. I mean, this is quite a sizable bit.
But I just want to get it clear. Are you saying then that you don't believe that Windscale can be the cause of those cancers, even though you are disturbed by the cancers themselves?
Pretty nearly. I think that the probability of Windscale being responsible for even one of them is small. The probability... I think that the thing which I dislike about the film is that it gives so much of the impression that this is due to radiation that it stops the investigation of what I believe is important. What are the real causes? May I ask...
I'd just like to allow Peter Wilkinson from Greenpeace to come in here. Now, here you have, on this side of the world, that Windscale is very unlikely, on the basis of the amount of plutonium that that has, in fact, been taken in, very unlikely to be the cause of those leukemias, those cancers. What is your
Well, I don't believe them. That's a simple answer. They said that dumping of radioactive waste at sea was safe. The international community said that that wasn't the case and it was stopped. They were wrong over the Windscale fire. They said that it created no damage whatsoever. In fact, it created over 30 thyroid cancers. They were wrong over the toxicity of plutonium. And the fact is that people aren't daft, you know. And people know that if you have a cancer-inducing agent and you're discharging it into the sea and it's coming back to the land, it's going to create problems. And I think for you to condemn people up in Cumbria to bring up their children in an atmosphere which is plutonium contaminated is a disgrace. And I think the majority of people looking at this programme will go along with me. And I would like an assurance from British Nuclear Fuels that you're going to stop the discharges, because if you don't stop it, Greenpeace will. And I think we'll stop it with public opinion. And I would very much appreciate that assurance from you right now.
Well, Mr. Mummery, give that assurance if you will, but would you also briefly add whether you would welcome a full inquiry now into the risks that Windscale poses as revealed?
Well, first of all, I mean, Peter Wilkinson there has made a large number of broad, sweeping statements unsupported by any scientific or technical facts
whatsoever. I have to ask you to deal with it briefly because of our time.
And I am dealing with it briefly by saying that. Right, I see no reason for a major investigation of the kind that you mount, for the reason I have mentioned, which is that the activity levels are well known. Professor Redford referred to the problems about the dust. In fact, that amount of dust that would have to be eaten is several hundred times more than it is physically possible. So there are these very large factors of safety in the analysis, Mr. Dimbleby.
Thank you, Mr. Mummery. Thank you all. Clearly, there is not much agreement about that round this table, but that's all we have time for tonight. The next First Tuesday will be in the first Tuesday in December. See you then, I hope. Good night.